Hello everyone, welcome to Economicspedia and welcome to the second part of CLRM where we are going to focus on the assumptions of the classical linear regression model. So these are part 2. Now before starting, let me rewrite the model that we were focusing in our part 1. I hope many of you remember it. If you don't, the model looks somewhat like this and we marked it as equation number 1. Now, if anyone of you interested to have a look at our first session where we discussed the basic concepts of CLRM, you can simply click on the card right over here appearing on your screen and follow that session as well. Okay, so this is our model. Now, coming back to our assumptions. Okay. Here, we are going to discuss the 10 assumptions of CLRM. Yes, 10 assumptions. So, please, just hold on to your seats because the session is going to be very interesting. Okay, so starting with assumption number 1. Now, we are talking about the assumptions of CLRM, classical linear regression model. So, L represents the linear. Now, first assumption is regarding this linearity of the model. So, you have to make sure that number one assumption says that you have to make sure that the models are linear in terms of parameters. So, number one assumption is linear in terms of the parameters. What are the parameters we have? Alpha and beta. So, it is important that alpha and beta are linear. No log, no exponential, no powers like square or to the power cube or quadratic, nothing. It has to be linear. Then first assumption is satisfied. Now moving on to our second assumptions. In our model, when we talk about this x, what is x? X is our regressor. So x has to be fixed for a particular sample that we are talking. That means no or non-stochasticity. So, x has to be non-stochastic in nature. That means non-random, stochastic or non-random. Either non-stochastic or non-random, any of the two. Okay, so x has to be non-random because if x change, then we cannot get our exact value of our estimated variables. And because the error terms will also get affected, that is why it is very important to have the regressors to be fixed. Okay? Or no stochasticity or randomness. Number third assumption we have regarding our error term. That is UI. So, UI. Third assumption says that the conditional mean value of error term has to be 0. Why this is so? In our first part also I have discussed that why the error term plays a very important role in the estimation procedure. So that is why here also the most of the assumptions will focus on the error term. So here the error term, that is the conditional mean, has to be 0. Now if you remember our first session also, I have discussed this same figure but with an SRF. Now here I am going to discuss this thing with the PRF. Now when there is a deviation, suppose this is x1, this is the this is where the error, it will be 0. So here anywhere UI lies, that will be positive, and here anywhere lies, there will be negative. Now if this is for x1, for x2, for x3, for x4, if we continually going on doing it, then we will have a summation of all over this thing, the positive values and the negative values, that will give us the assumption of number 3, that is conditional mean of error term is 0. Okay. Moving to number 4, which is also known as homoscedasticity. Now, homoscedasticity means what? Here, the variance of the error term, that has to be sigma square. What is this sigma square means? Sigma square is basically showing constant variance. Now, if this homoscedasticity condition is not satisfied, then we have the problem of heteroscedasticity. Absolutely right. So here we have the problem of heteroscedasticity when the variance of error is not equal to sigma I, but variance of error is equal to sigma I square. That means here I represents that the value of sigma square will vary as per the samples vary. So here the problem of heteroscedasticity arises. Now you can have my session on heteroscedasticity also by clicking on the card over here. If you are interested, do have a look at this session as well. So this is about the fourth assumption. Now let's move to the fifth assumption. Fifth assumption is also regarding the error term. So here the error term or the assumption says non-autocorrelation. Autocorrelation, or this is also sometimes known as no serial correlation. Okay. Serial correlation. So these terms represent the same thing. That means no correlation or no autocorrelation or no serial correlation. This represents what? Covariance of ui uj given xi xj, this is equal to zero. That means what? Here there is no correlation or no relation between the error term of two different samples. That means suppose we have two samples x I and j, then the error term of the two samples will not be correlated. They will be independent of each other. That means the effect of one error term on the dependent variable is something different than what the other error term is having. They are not related. And this is very much important to have in our assumptions, because if this assumption is not satisfied, then we have a problem which is known as the autocorrelation problem. So that is why it is very much important to satisfy this assumption as well. Now moving on to assumption number 6. Okay, so assumption number 6 is zero covariance again, but this time between the error term and the regressor. So here it says zero covariance between the error term and the regressor. A mathematical expression, then it is covariance of ui and xi is equal to zero. That means the error term and the regressors are not related to each other, because if that happens, then again the effect of x and u on y, effect of x and u on y will not be separately measured. Okay, so that is why it is very much important to have this assumption where there is no correlation between the error term and the regressor. Okay, then it will help us to analyze the method, analyze the model, and we will be getting the OLS estimates of alpha and beta in a more better way. Okay, so this is about assumption number 6. Let's move to assumption number 7. Okay, assumption number 7 says n has to be greater than k. What is n? N is our total observation and k is our number of regressors. So this is number of observations and k is our number of explanatory variables, or you can say the regressors. Okay, these are assumption number 7. Moving on to 8, which says the variability in x. So whenever we have a particular sample, it is very much recommended to have the values of x's to be different. That means the values cannot be similar to similar in at least a particular sample that we are considering. Because if the values of x's are not same, then similarly we will not be getting the values of y's and we will not be getting the values of u's. That means the error term. Okay, because if you remember our diagram, this is x, this is y, this is our PRF. So due to x's, we were getting the values, isn't it? So that is why having the variability in x is very important. Okay, now number 9 is where we talk about expressing the regression model. So here the regression model needs to be specified in a proper way. What does that mean? Measuring, specifying the model in a proper way. Proper way, it means the models are specified in a correct form. Okay, by correct form, it will help us to, just reduce the specification bias or specification error. So to reduce, this is important for specification error or specification bias. Now these problems will arise if we do not satisfy our assumption number 9. That is, if the models are not specified in a correct way. Now, one more thing that can arise due to this regression model when it is not specified in a proper way is this thing. What is this specification error and specification bias? When we have the model which is required to be estimated, but it is either overestimated or underestimated. Now, the reason for this over or underestimation is due to this non-specification of the model in a proper way. And then we have the problem of this specification bias and or specification error, whatever you want to call it. Okay, so this is our assumption number 9. And finally, we are moving towards our assumption number 10. That is multicollinearity. Actually, the assumption is no multicollinearity. No multicollinearity. Now, this is an assumption that actually do not play a very important role when we talk about our CLRM, because here the regressor model, the regressor is only one regressor. And this multicollinearity takes place the role when we have more than one regressors. What is this multicollinearity actually is? We are going to have a session on that as well. So, I'm just going to give you a brief over the multicollinearity. So, multicollinearity is the situation when the two regressors are related. So, relation between two regressor model is again not appreciated in our analysis also. Alright? So, that is why no multicollinearity is also one of the assumptions of CLRM, because this plays a role when we have more than one regressor. Okay, so that is all about the assumptions of CLRM. I really hope that these sessions are helpful to you. And if it is, you know what to do. If you are new to our channel, do subscribe to our channel and hit the bell icon so that you never miss any update from our page. And if you like the sessions, show us your support by hitting the like button. And also give us your suggestions on what topic that you want us to make take the sessions on. Thank you very much. Have a great day, everyone. And keep your preparations on for the upcoming exams. And see you soon in one of my next sessions.